Yeah, we don't call ourselves a trucking company. Any analyst that might want to come and see us, because we're publicly listed, and for quite a long time, the analyst community here in New Zealand referred to us as a trucking company or a New Zealand trucking company. And I suppose you can understand that with the predominance of the brand on the road. But we're far from it. And hopefully by the end of this conversation that I'm having with you guys, you might understand Mainfreight a little better and know why we want to call it a global logistics business. So I just thought I'd take you through who we are and what we are and where we are. We commenced business in 1978, and that was the founding chairman, who's now the executive chairman, calls himself the executive chairman so that he can interfere every day. But he started the business in 1978 in Auckland and had a vision of being the best possible freight business that there was in New Zealand. He came out of the freight community here, was a regulated community, and poor quality, poor profits, mostly dominated by Australian transport companies. So very quickly we grew into a larger business, principally because we bought better freight quality to the New Zealand transport system. We aspire to be a global logistics business, and we're currently trading in 233 branches across 20 odd countries around the world, so with 5,771 people. We expect to be in Vietnam before the end of the year, Malaysia likely next year, Philippines is being discussed at the moment, and unfortunately with the political troubles in Turkey, not likely to be there for a little while yet. So we're in logistics. So what is logistics? Well, we could pull it out of the dictionary and give you the exact description, or if we want to put it simply, it actually means having the right thing in the right place at the right time. And as the logistics world, particularly in the last probably 3 to 5 years, has become a lot tighter and a lot more efficient, this delivery on time is crucial. And as the retail sector changes, particularly with the advent of internet commerce, the delivery of product on time all the time, the expectations of people to have deliveries has heightened greatly. In the early days when we started in 1978, we would move freight from Auckland, say, here to Dunedin, and we could take 10 to 15 days to get it here. Whereas today, if we haven't got it delivered on the third morning, the customer is likely to leave us. And if you're an internet buyer, you would expect that to be delivered tomorrow morning. So logistics has risen in the eyes of our customers, of the directors. It's become a strategic decision. Decisions are becoming more global, hence our reason to actually have to get offshore. And it's becoming more important. Now, the opportunity for us out of that means that there's more freight for us to move. The way we started the business was the way we wanted to continue, and that was to have a business that was a little different to those that were here prior to us. So we're interested in wanting to create a 100-year company, and that drives all our decisions. So we like to own our own property. We've got a balance sheet of about $950 million, 350 of that is in property, both New Zealand, Australia and in Europe. And that's about wanting to have the business for the long term rather than short term. We could probably make the balance sheet look a whole lot smarter if we were to take those properties off the balance sheet, float them in a little property company somewhere, as all the smart suits of Queen Street would like us to do. But actually for the long term of the business, the long term future of the business, we like to own. Therefore, the decisions we take are all about long-term decisions. Everything that we do in the business is about how will this affect us in 20 years and 30 years and 40 years. We could make very good short-term profit now by making short-term profit decisions. Our style is to make long-term decisions. We want to be around for a long time. We seek to delight our customers, under-promise and over-deliver. And we try and do that with the market as well. You won't find us out in the marketplace boasting about what next year's profits will be. We'd like to play under the radar screen, and we do the same with our customers. High quality focus and measurement. We set very high standards and we try and beat them. The key for us is we don't have any widgets or gadgets. It's about our people. So our people are very key. We spend about $5 million a year on training and development of our people. So all sorts of courses, leadership courses, training courses, be it on a forklift, hazardous goods licenses. We take our people away to Outward Bound three times a year from all around the world to put them through the Outward Bound course that's got a Mainfreight flavour to it. The mistake we made on the first course was we didn't tell the people from China and the people from America that we didn't have any dangerous animals in our bush, and they have to sit out in the bush for a couple of days on their own, and of course the possums scared the hell out of them and we had the Chinese running back to base. But it's about pulling the team together and about spending a lot of money making sure that we've got the very best people in the business. This is really key for us, is that we only promote from within. So you won't find us in the marketplace with adverts looking for branch managers or, for that matter, managing directors, hopefully. But we're looking to promote from within. So you come to work for us, you start on the floor, you start with a broom and you start with a forklift and you learn how to load freight. And then you work your way through the business. And out of that, the opportunities to run quite large business units within Mainfreight becomes a vision for a lot of our people. And we've got quite a lot of young people, young grads, that have started with us sort of 5 to 10 years prior, holding quite large responsible roles with us. We share our profit. 10% of the profit is shared equally in a branch. The branch has got to make a profit. So it's got to have 10% there to be able to share, and that's split equally. And then there's a little bit for up unders and overs for those that have reached their quality stats. Our profit this year was $149.5 million EBITDA, Kiwi, and we've just finished writing cheques for $15 million, which we've shared with everybody in the business. Bureaucracy, hierarchy and superiority is not tolerated. No one's got a private office. I don't have an office. I don't have a car park. And wherever we can, we try and get rid of this thing called bureaucracy. No red tape in our business. There's no memos. Too many emails, but no memos in the business. We expect people to pick up the phone and do business with each other. We manage the business on a weekly basis. So on a Monday night, Tuesday morning, we know exactly how much money we've made in all those 233 branches. More importantly, the leaders of those branches understand how much money they've made or lost. So we can calculate it and stand up there and beat our chests about what the profit looks like. But more importantly, the branch manager, him or her, understand the decisions they made last week and what that's done to the bottom line in the business. And then we put that up on the cafeteria walls. So it's shared with everybody. So those that have been working on the dock, loading rail wagons or trucks, understand what that hard work has done in terms of the bottom line. And of course, they share in that bottom line at the end of the year. There's no cross-subsidisation between the business, and I've talked about long-term profit. We're a very different business to what we were 5 years ago. We're very different to what we were when we first started. So we keep reinventing ourselves. And the textbooks here in this university, I'm sure, will talk about strategic plans and budgets. We don't do any of that. No strategic plan. Don't misinterpret that for not understanding our strategic direction, but no strategic plan. We don't waste the time and then put it in the bottom drawer like a lot of businesses do and then get on and run the business. Same as budgeting. If you think about a budget, it's a set of numbers and you're trying to guess the year ahead. Guess what the revenue is, tweak the margin, tweak the costs, and hopefully you got a profit. Put that in front of the board of directors and hopefully the GFC doesn't turn up or a tsunami doesn't turn up. The reality is the weekly profit that we measure on a Monday night is compared to the same week the year prior. And all we're trying to do is beat that year prior. It's as much as the distraction that we take for the people. They don't have to get themselves buried into a budget for 3 months to satisfy a board of directors who will probably say yes or no. I mean, the reality is business has moved a long way in those 3 months that you're trying to put a budget together. When we went to Australia, that was back in sort of 1998. We bought quite a large business, spent 30 odd million, and subsequently lost 20 million in the next couple of years. And we went there with a Kiwi attitude. And we kept referring, this is the way we do it in New Zealand, and we learnt a valuable lesson. You can imagine what the Aussies thought of that. It was the one-finger salute, and they did not want to know how we did it in New Zealand. And it taught us a really valuable lesson about working in different countries. And as we've done that, it's actually helped us as we've gone to Asia, as we've gone to the USA, and now that we're in Europe, and you can imagine, you think doing business with the Aussies is hard, trying to do business between the French, the Germans and the Belgians, and then throw a little Dutch flavour to the equation, and it's very difficult to get those people working together. So all the things that we learnt going to Aussie back in those days of the late 90s and early 2000s taught us a lot. Ultimately, whilst we've got some Kiwis running those businesses all around the world, we would like to have nationals running those businesses. You know, we'd like to have, and we have got a senior Asian woman running our China business. We would like to find somebody in the Netherlands to run that European business. And we've got Kiwis in Europe and Kiwis in America, which works for the moment, but preferably we'd like them to do it our way. Quite quickly, once we got to Aussie in the early 2000s, our offshore revenue grew quite quickly. So today, you know, 2 billion thereabouts of revenue, 74% is earned offshore. And you can see, once we bought in Europe and we've started to really find some traction in the US business, you can start to see the difference that it makes to be in those bigger markets. And I think that's the key. And if there's anything that's smart that we've got to say to New Zealand businesses, it's get yourself offshore to those bigger countries. You've actually got to hone your skills here in a really competitive market, but once you've done that and you've got profit here, and as long as you've got profit at home, that can help you fund your ventures offshore. But you can see what a big market does, or bigger markets do for us. In terms of EBITDA, not quite as good, but you know, very quickly the offshore businesses will surpass what we make here in New Zealand. So 55% is earned offshore. And we expect that to continue to increase. All those problems of losing that money in Aussie in the early 2000s, it won't be long, probably a year or two, where Australia will surpass New Zealand in terms of profitability. So again, it's the size of the market that's exciting for us. Our strategy for global supply chain logistics business, world-class service. It's the only thing that works. And it's the only thing that differentiates ourselves to the others. So we've got to be better than the big guys. We move around the world for air and ocean. For ocean, we move about 250,000 20-foot, the equivalent of 20-foot containers, TEUs, and about 60 million kilos of air freight. Our biggest competitor, Kuehne+Nagel and DHL aren't far off, are about 4 million 20-foot containers. So we're quite small. So we've got to try and differentiate ourselves in that bigger market. And quality is one of those. And then we provide a logistics service across the full range. So, you know, some examples would be a customer in Shanghai. We would pick it up in Shanghai, ship it to Auckland, cart it off the wharf, customs clear it, devan the container, put it in a warehouse, receive the orders electronically, pick and pack, and deliver to home or to retail. That's the full supply chain. And we do bits and pieces of that, and we've got about 40,000 customers doing either some of that or all of that. And not just Shanghai to Auckland. I mean, very quickly, once we got to China, the China to US trade lane became bigger than any of the trade lanes that we had trading to New Zealand and Australia. Very sophisticated technology. We spend about 14 or 15 million a year on technology, our own technology. It's the only way that we can find a difference and to ensure we stay in front of the pack. We prefer our own network. In the world of logistics, if you use an agent offshore, you split the profit 50-50. So if it's our own business offshore, the profit stays in the bigger company. And we look to, you know, large multinational customers trading across our network and trying to be really useful for our customers. I suppose an example of a large multinational customer, we've just quoted for Heinz, just for their canned goods, from the Netherlands to Germany. They said to us, look, it's only a small piece of the business. It's 100,000 pallets a year. Well, we'd be lucky to move 100,000 pallets for, and we do most of the distribution for the Progressive supermarkets, and that's for everything that Progressive have. So, and this is one customer, one small part of their supply chain, just from the Netherlands to Germany. So you can see the scale as you get around the world. And, you know, we've gained that business because we're useful for that customer in the way that we've gone about the business. Because this is being taped and it's a little public, I haven't put the numbers in here of how much we move, but you get the picture. This is how we trade around the world, and our air and ocean business is likely to be our biggest business as time comes. Right now, New Zealand, Australia and American domestic businesses probably equate to a little more than the air and ocean that we do. But once you get the air and ocean business, you make the connection within the country. So if you get the freight from Shanghai to LA, there's a good chance you'll get the warehousing, or at least quote for it. You'll definitely get the wharf cartage, and then you'll be able to quote for the distribution to retail throughout America. So those are the opportunities that come from being in a global air and ocean business. But as you can see, we're starting to trade with most countries around the world. We're not in all those countries. We think that South America, the moment we have a bigger and stronger business in Europe, we're likely to find ourselves in Brazil. So we're only in Chile at the moment. And the Brazil work that we send there is through an agent. But if you go to Brazil, and some of our biggest competitors are there, Darksa is an example from Germany. Why are they there? There's 550 German manufacturing companies based in Brazil. So a German forwarder gets preference to that work. So once we're stronger in Germany, we've got an opportunity to get there. Africa, big problem for us, full of corruption, very hard to do business, and not a lot of freight in terms of what we do. A lot of oil exploration, a lot of project work, but not a lot for LCL freight like we move around the world. So some time to come before we see ourselves in Africa. China obviously has been exceptional for us, and the Southeast Asian region will become stronger as we build ourselves into that market. And if you think about the free trade agreements that are going on at the moment, you know, I was on a trade mission with John Key to Thailand, and that ASEAN region has 12 members to it, and it's half the population of China and half the gross economic value. But it's 12 decisions, whereas China, you know, 1.4 billion people, but it's one decision. And we saw what happens to Fonterra when one decision can play against the business. So the ASEAN region becomes even more important to trade, particularly for New Zealand. As I've said, our air and ocean business is our preference in terms of getting greater potential for growth. You know, in terms of working within the business, we'd like to strengthen our own network, so we ditch an agent, get into a country, work with an agent, either buy the agent or look to do it ourselves, control the freight and do that. We like to retain that profit within the group, and we do a lot of perishable air freight, so we're trying to establish perishable. If you think about New Zealand being a food basket, we're moving a lot of food northbound into the northern hemisphere through air freight. We do about 25 million tonnes of perishable out of New Zealand now, the largest off the Auckland airport. And we've linked that with a perishable network in Australia and are likely to do the same in LA and in Europe. So we can link them all together. Just some pictures for you. Just to give you a feel for what we do and the scope of the stuff, we're spending about $50 million in Christchurch. This is the new facility in Christchurch. This here is what we own in Christchurch, all this area here. We sustained some damage in the Christchurch earthquake, but not a lot. But it gave us the impetus to actually make some changes. And as the Christchurch rebuild took its time, we chose to spend our money early, engage those builders who weren't engaged by the government or in the rebuild, and we got a cheaper price for the change in our operation. This is in Auckland. This is on the way to the airport. It's one of 12 operations in Auckland. This is a chilled warehouse, and this is another chilled warehouse where we will do a lot more foodstuffs and a lot more beverage for the supermarket trade. This is in Hamilton, so that's the main trunk line there in Tarapa. So we're on about 18 sites with rail-served facilities. Some of those we own, some Kiwi Rail own. We built a new facility in Hamilton 9 years ago, and we outgrew it within five. So, and if you think about the demographics of Hamilton, Tauranga and Auckland, we're likely to see them come closer together. So therefore, Hamilton plays a big role in our distribution network here in New Zealand. Australia is Sydney, and we expect to build a second one on the other side of the city. So this here is twice the size of the Auckland facility, twice the size of the Auckland, that the previous slide that we saw for warehousing. World-class facility. You know, I've seen a few freight facilities around the world over the years, and this would be one of the best that we've got. Just the warehousing, you can see what we do inside the warehouse. Very neat and tidy, a lot of foodstuffs, a lot of beverage. This is our Australian site. We've just spent $60 million building that in Brisbane, in a little place called Larapinta. Again, warehousing and distribution. That's the distribution site. That's the warehousing site. In Melbourne, we're currently here. We've just bought 10 hectares of land in the north of the city, and we're looking at buying another 10 hectares in the south. The cities in these bigger countries are so big that you actually have to have two big facilities to actually become efficient in terms of your logistics. So it means a lot of investment. We'll spend $100 million this year on building infrastructure and another $100 million next year just to get New Zealand and Australia up to speed with our facilities. We don't own anything in America, and we don't own anything in China. We own about $50 million euro of facilities in Europe. This is where we are. So this is in the south of the Netherlands on the Dutch border. This is where the headquarters are. I'll show you a photo of that. So we're through the western area, and then we've opened in Poland. We've opened in Romania. We've opened in Ukraine. So we're in a couple of war zones. We're in Moscow. We're in Finland. And, you know, we've got Thailand, the unrest that's going on there, and we've got the unrest that's going on between the Ukraine and the Russians. We had our Ukrainian lady who runs the operation come to a meeting to meet us in Amsterdam, and she got to the airport and they turned a car over because she was, looking to leave the country and the unrest that was going on. And this is people working for you is sort of hard to comprehend. A lady in Russia hasn't been allowed to travel for the last 12 months. And, of course, in the last month or so, that's become more difficult. It's a site that we've got in Sederenburg. They line them up like that every Saturday afternoon after they've cleaned the trucks, so they're not just there for the photo. That's the warehouse. It's 25 acres. You see the difference in economies of scale? All here is John Deere tractors. So we import the tractors in broken down condition, in a CKD form from America, and we put them together. We've almost got a small factory line that actually has a higher quality level than the factory line in Moline in the USA. And we put aftermarket parts on those tractors and then ship those all over the world. But in here, there's specialized bikes and gear. There's a lot of multinational customers. Unilever is one of them. Beiersdorf, which is your Nivea cream and so forth, is the other. It's a mechanized logistics pick and pack operation for specialized bikes. It's all the cycling gear for specialized, the American company. Put together by, all designed by a couple of young grads that work for us in the Sarenburg office. And we bought the gear, and it saved the customer about 12% in terms of cost and made us more efficient, made them more efficient. Beiersdorf, a lot of foodstuffs, a lot of grocery. In the United States, we've got 60-odd operations between Caratrans and Mainfreight throughout the USA. Some larger branches, which really the top six, you know, Los Angeles, Dallas, Atlanta, New York, Chicago, San Francisco. And those are the areas where we're running just exactly what you see here on the road, Mainfreight trucks running between the centres with freight being loaded and unloaded and out for delivery. It's one of the greatest things to be on the Los Angeles freeway, six lanes, and the Mainfreight truck comes to you from the other direction. It does the ego a lot of good, I tell you. Just some shots of the Mainfreight business. Brand's exactly the same. We do a lot of cars out of America to New Zealand and Australia and now into Europe. When the dollar is trading like it is, it's very cheap for people to import the cars. And we have a service where we move about 400 containers a year of cars just from LA to New Zealand. Similar, little different in terms of the layout of the docks and so forth, and we're learning a lot from the European and American operations. In Asia, we've got about 12 operations throughout China, Hong Kong, about to open our second operation in Thailand. We're in Singapore on Changi Airport. It just opened in Taipei for Taiwan business, but you know, it's this area in here that we expect to really develop. China is starting to change the world of logistics like it did sort of 15 to 20 years ago. The trade lanes of the world were changed because of manufacturing in China. Cheap labour, particularly on the East Coast. The labour cost on the East Coast is increasing at about 10% per annum. And it's a very transient labour force. So for us, it's hard to hold on to people, let alone major manufacturers. And what we're finding is the American manufacturers are starting, because it's about a 26 to 30 day transit time to America. And what we're starting to see, because of the labor rates in Mexico, and Mexico becoming a near-shoring operation for logistics. So now the manufacturers are actually moving from China to Mexico, and you've only got about a 9-day transit time for the freight. So you think about the capital that it's deployed for the product once it's paid for and so forth. It's a whole lot easier perhaps to have it done in Mexico, or what they call near-shoring. So it's changing the face of manufacturing in China. Doesn't mean to say that it's finished. I mean, they've still got a lot of work to do. Still, it's the biggest freight market in the world, and we are very small out of there. Technology, we continue to invest in that and delivers efficiency for us and productivity gains. Provides customers with transparency across the full supply chain, so you can see all that on an app that we have. You can see it through a mode that we've got on the system. It ensures us competitive advantage. In the early 90s, we had about this much advantage. Today, we'd be lucky to have this much. Everybody's catching up, and it's a big part to play in terms of logistics. If you think about what we do, we know more sometimes about the customer's products than what the customer does. We understand where the customers are. We understand who's buying, who's selling, where it's moving from, what the costs are. So we own a lot of information on behalf of the customer. At some point in time, that's going to be valuable for us. It's valuable now, but we might be able to do more with it as we grow. Spend in 2014, $11.5 million. We just put everyone on a common database across the world. We're not on the cloud yet, but thinking about that's where we need to be. Hard platforms located in Asia, America, and Europe, and here in New Zealand. Our portal, customer portal, is called Mainchain. Upgrading our transport system in Europe and upgrading the New Zealand and Australian domestic software. I think we're bigger than IBM, but the IT guys don't believe in that. Our people are our greatest asset, and our culture recognises that. It's the thing that, if anyone asks me what I do, the most I do will be to flick the culture wheel. It's all about maintaining our people, the training, the development of them. And the biggest concern I would have in business any day is leadership and the people that are coming to allow us to open another branch or open in another country. It's the one thing that focuses your mind when you're developing a business around the world. So we promote from within, as I've said, 5,771 at the moment. In terms of recruitment, Mainfreight could be part of your future. We took on 44 grads last year, and I think 7 of those came from Otago. And that's just in the last year. So there's plenty that are in the business already. You get a career with us, and if you want to do your OE, you still get a career with us. Whereas we used to get grumpy 2 or 3 years in the business here, learn the trade, and then you'd all want to go and pour a beer in England or something. And we used to get grumpy about that. Now we embrace those people and we send them off and work for us in Europe, and they're working for us in Asia and in America. So you get this career. It's a long-term career. We're a long-term business. Culture, we work hard and we play hard. We enjoy the business. There's no bullshit. You get to make real decisions, learn locally and progress globally. If you feel like having a fast-paced business to work in, come and grow with us. To close, we've got ambitions to be in every major trading nation of the world. New Zealand, Australia providing useful profit and helping us expand around the world. When New Zealand had all the profit, it helped us in Aussie. Now we've got Aussie and New Zealand providing that profit. It's helping us develop around the world. High quality freight services delivered by good, intelligent, energetic people. To come and work for us, you've got to have an attitude. You want to get up and go. You want to be positive. You actually want to make things happen. Acquisitions, sometimes, quite large ones over the years. Some work, some don't. They're very difficult to do. They've got to fit our jigsaw, but we prefer organic growth. Sales would be our biggest issue outside of leadership and people. Asia, USA and Europe, we have high expectations of our growth in those three markets. We expect that most of that growth is to come from air and ocean, and then we'll develop the logistics behind it. And just a word from our chairman, the guy that started the business, that he's the executive chairman, so he can still interfere every day. We'll continue to seek growth and excellence, and profit will follow. That's Mainfreight today. I was here about 5 years ago. It's a bit different. We've changed a bit. Probably some of those people that were there then have got a career with us. Hopefully some of you might want to have a career for us.